I would like to dedicate this talk to Vesselin Drensky on the occasion of his 70th birthday. So happy new happy birthday, Vesco, again, and I wish you all the best and to be healthy and to doing so beautiful master as you do. So
thank you.
Yeah, I would like to. This is a joint work with Vesselin Drensky, and the talk is about Margarete Wolf, the symmetric polynomials in non-commutative variables and non-commutative invariant talk. And as Vesco told, this is a satellite talk to this web seminar. And of course, we are thank you to some to our grant. And let me start with the fundamental theorem of symmetric polynomials, which of course every math student knows. Every symmetric polynomial can be expressed in a unique way as a polynomial of the elementary symmetric polynomial. So if we fix a field K with a set of d variables, so we consider the polynomial algebra, and we'll write in short in such a way, and define the action of symmetric group of degree d in such a way. So any permutation sends a polynomial of the variable to the polynomial, but just permutates the variables. And of course, the algebra of symmetric polynomials is generated by this E1, E2, ED. And of course, we can say that if S is a symmetric polynomial, then there exists a unique polynomial of d variables such that the symmetric polynomial equals the polynomial of d variables, but the polynomial of the elementary symmetric functions. In other words, the elementary symmetric polynomials are algebraically independent. And of course, the well-known are the Wyatt formulas. If we have an algebraic equation which has some rules x1 to xd, and they are related to the elementary symmetric polynomials of roots, and the coefficients are related in such a way. And this is from the original paper of V.S. And maybe not so many, it's not known too much history about these theorems, but details can be found in the paper of von Hauser. Okay, I'm not going to cite this, but so much nice words are said about these formulas and the bias work. And so we continue with the invariant theory and the following generalization. So let's field deal with characteristic zero and the group of the general linear group of degree d is the consists of course of d by d invertible matrices, and they act canonically from the left on the vector space with the basis xd. And this action is extended diagonally on the polynomial algebra by the rule in this way. G of f with this with variables x1 to xd is actually f and g of x1 and xd. So if G is a subgroup of a general linear group of degree D, then the algebra of G invariants actually consists of all polynomials of D variables such that are invariants under the action of the elements of the group G. So the image of the polynomial F is exactly F. And usually, one can consider another action of a general linear group that assumes that this group acts on a d-dimensional vector space with a basis v1 to vd, one can define the xi as a mapping from this vector space to the field k in, by the rule, project on the xi coordinate. And if f is a polynomial of d variable and g is an element of a general linear group, so the image of f under the g is actually this element sends v to f of the inverse of the g of v. Okay, both ways do not differ essentially. The group, the general linear group and its opposites are actually isomorphic by this this mapping. So if we map g to the inverse of g transpose, so we'll get almost the same. The classical action of a general linear group on the polynomials actually considered as a function is the same as our diagonal action. And this indices by a canonical action from the left on general linear group on the vector space with basis this set x, d. But for our generalization is more convenient to consider our action on general linear group. And the problem that the problem is to describe this g invariant of the polynomial algebra. So the first natural problem is algebra of g invariant polynomials is finitely generated from for all subgroup of g of the general linear group of degree d. And this is the main motivation for the 14th problem of Hubert from the International Congress in Mathematicians in Paris, 19th century. Okay, if the group is finite, so the answer is given by Emmy Noether and the answer is yes. If the group is reductive, so we can say in some sense nice, so the answer is again yes. Okay, this is not stated in this generality, but the non-constructive proof is contained in the work of Hilbert. But in general case, the answer is no, and we have a counterexample of Nagata in 1950s. The origins of invariant theory can be found in the work of Lagrange, is 1770 in Gauss. But the real invariant theory began in 1940 with the work by George Bull in England and Toto Hesse in Germany. Later the further development of the theory continued in the work for the plethora of distinguished mathematicians, among them Cayley, Sylvester, Glebsch, Jordan, Hilbert, and so many. The second problem is, if the g invariant of a polynomial algebra is generated by some set of f1, fm, then it is a homomorphic image of polynomial algebra of m variables. So the problem here is to find the generators of the ideal of the kernel. And to find the explicit set of generators for different groups G. What is the Hilbert basis Satz? So this is the theorem says that every ideal of polynomial algebra is finitely generated. and the constructed the proof is not constructive. And there is one myth, and I would like to say about this. And as another non-constructive proof of the Hilbert, the proof of this theorem was accepted skeptically by many of his temporary mathematicians. And Jordan commented the proof as das ist nicht Mathematik, das ist Theology. But it's not clear that if Jordan really said this, or since that the earliest reference to it is actually 25 years after the event and after his death, or we are not sure if it is a clear quote was intended as a criticism or a subtitle of George. So Jordan encouraged Hilbert and used Hilbert's results and methods. And this widespread story that he opposites Hilbert's works on invariant theory, actually, it turns out, is a myth. We have a Chevalier Shepard taught theorem. So, if for finite group G, G invariants, algebra of G invariants is actually isomorphic to the polynomial algebra of D variable, if and only if the group G, which is a subgroup of a general linear group, is generated by pseudo-random reflections. Actually, the matrix is a finite multiplicative order with all eigenvalues except 1 equals 1. Now, how many are the invariants? We have the G invariants of polynomial algebra K, XD is a graded vector space. So if we have that this algebra, we let's say that this is just R, is a direct sum of its homogeneous components, where R0, R1, and so on, and this Ri is the vector space of the homogeneous polynomials of degree n correspondingly. So we have that the G invariant is also a graded, is a graded, and this is a direct sum of the homogeneous components correspondingly of G invariants. And then the Hilbert series of this algebra of G invariants is the formal parallel series where we have the the coefficient in front of Zn are just the dimension of this homogeneous component of G invariant algebra. So the Moulin formula says that if the group is finite, then the Hilbert series is given by this formula. And this is when the group is finite, but if the group is infinite, we just have to replace the sum with integral. There is another theorem that say that if G is a reductive, so the Hilbert series is a rational function. Now, let's have a look what happens if in the non-commutative cases. So let us replace the polynomial algebra KXD with another non-commutative algebra, and now we would like to see which properties are the same and what is the difference actually, and with which algebra we are going to replace the polynomial algebra. So the most natural candidate, of course, is the pre-associative algebra KXD. This is the algebra of polynomials in D non-commuting variables. So this algebra has the same universal property as the polynomial algebra of D variables. So what what is this property. So if R is a commutative algebra, then every mapping from this set X to a commutative algebra R can be extended in a unique way from the polynomial algebra to the commutative algebra. And we have the same if the R is an associative algebra. We can extend every mapping from the set XD to the associative algebra in a unique way to a homomorphism to the free algebra to this associative algebra R. And now the problem is to describe the symmetrical polynomials in this free algebra. Answer is given by Wolf, the Margarete Wolf, which we are talking about in the paper of from 1936, and the paper is symmetric function of non-commutative elements. Next step is to develop the non-commutative invariant theory and study the G invariants of this algebra of non-commutative polynomial in D variables. And even going further, just to consider another G invariant algebra where if XD will be another, but to have these universal properties similar to the polynomial algebra or free algebra of polynomials in non-commutative variables, for example, Lie algebra or a free non-associative algebra and so on. Okay, this because we are satellite talk to a women conference, I would like to mention who is Margarete Wolf. I'm not going into the details. But she's an American mathematician born in the family where mother is German, father is American. The interesting fact is that Margaret and her older sister are probably the only example that exactly at that time, the early 90s, finishing their, defended their PhD thesis. And not only in mathematics, exactly in algebra. And for the history, we have followed this book, Pioneering Women in American Mathematicians. They have the same PhD advisor, Mark Ingraham. And this is a citation, and so much nice words said from both of the his PhD students, Margaret and Louise. They defended their PhD studies in University of Wisconsin. And some word about Ingraham, and he received her undergraduate degree from Cornell University. After that, go to serve in forces in Europe during the First World War. After that, back to the university, finishing his PhD, master and PhD. But probably the most curious fact is that he established the first academic computer centers in the United States in the University of Wisconsin campus. Okay, let's concentrate a bit of the personality of Margarete Wolf. She defended her thesis, symmetric functions of matrices. And after that, publish results in the paper which we consider it, and another three paper. But after that, married, moved, children, and continue her career in another university and doing only teaching. So I'm not sure that I have too much time, so we are going back to mathematics. And I would like to to say about the main result of Margarete Wolf. So let K be any field, and XD is a set of some variables more than one, X1 to XD. And the free associative algebra has a basis containing the set XD of the monomials, such monomials in the non-commutative variables XD. The symmetric group acts on this free associative algebra as in the commutative case. So we have this action, and of course the polynomial of non-commuting variables is symmetric if it's invariant under the action of the any permutation. And of course we are going to use the standard notation of the sum of F is actually, we mean that this is the sum of all permutation of F, where the permutation runs in the symmetric group. So this correspond for the polynomial F, this is the actually the corresponding symmetric polynomial. And the symmetric group SD of degree D acts on the set of monomials and split it in orbits. And if we choose one monomial U from each orbit, then the symmetric free associative algebra has the basis all such some of you. Now this is a citation from the introduction of the paper of Margarete Wolf of symmetric polynomials, and we would like to translate in our language. So the theorem says that the algebra of symmetric polynomials is a free associative algebra, and it has a homogeneous system of free generators, the set of FJ, for such that for any n there is at least one generator of degree n, and the number of homogeneous polynomials of degree n is the same in every homogeneous free generating system. So if F is a symmetric polynomial and has the presentation, it's sum of products of the polynomials from this set of free generators with some coefficient alpha p from the field. Actually, this coefficient alpha p is a linear coefficient, a linear combination of the with integer coefficients. Of the coefficients of the polynomial F. And this is the sketch of and slightly modified original proof. So if we order the monomials in U we would like to order them lexicographically. And assuming the ordering that x1 is greater than x2 and so on, then the leading monomial of this sum actually has the following properties, and this is very essential, and that is that the first index actually i1 is exactly 1, and if we have a monomial like this, so let's consider the first k variables, and after that let's have another monomials, and the first k depending essentially from x1 to xp, and the k plus 1 variable is not one. Is different from 1 to p, then we can say that this indices is exactly p plus 1. So we have in k plus 1 position, we have x p plus 1. So these are very, very important observations, how the leading monomial looks like. So every monomial u satisfying these two properties is actually the leading monomial of this symmetric polynomial. So let's consider the leading monomials u of some symmetric polynomials for small degrees. And obviously, when we have a degree 1 and 1 variable, so we have one monomial. When we have two degrees, the second degrees, and could have one or two variables, so we have two. Here we have for the degree 3, we have 3. Here we have 15. This is also part of the research of Margarete Wolf, and there is a table with symmetric polynomials, the leading terms actually of the symmetric polynomials for small degrees and for a small number of variables. So this is actually the table. So this is the degree 1, degree 1 variables. Here we have 2. Here we have 5, 15, and so on. But now, let us make a remark that the leading, we shall denote the leading monomial of one polynomial variable by F bar. And obviously, the leading monomial of the product of two polynomials, of two non-zero polynomials, if f1 and f2, equals to the product of their leading monomials. So it's the product of f1 bar and f2 bar. And this is the part of the proof. So of course we. We do it by induction, and we want to construct this set of generating set of leading monomials, and of course the base of our induction is this symmetric polynomials, and we would like to construct another one. And what we are going to use and to find that if we have if we have a leading monomial of the form ended by the variable x1, so actually we can prove that this can be expressed as a polynomial of already constructed polynomials of the generating set of the symmetric polynomials in the non-commutative algebra. And this will be almost the same if we have a leading term of the type, if we have x1 and x2 somewhere in the middle, but at least this term v1 has, this monomial has degree greater than 0. So if we have such a monomial, so this also can be expressed as a polynomial of already constructed polynomials of the generating set. So the main conclusion here is to see that the leading monomial of symmetric polynomial f of degree greater than 1 can be presented as a product of two leading monomials of symmetric polynomials of lower degree of u, if u is neither of the form this one to finish of the x1 nor of the form x1 and x2 to be somewhere in the middle and closed from some other terms. And then we can add the symmetric polynomials to some of U to the generating system of the symmetric polynomials. And the polynomials of constructed the generating sets are free generators of course of this symmetric of algebra, because the leading monomial of every symmetric polynomial can be expressed in a unique way as a product of leading monomial of the system. And this is also from the paper of the Margarete Wolf. And now, from the first degree, we have just one. This is the this leading monomial here. We have the second one. If you remember, here we this is here state one monomial that ended of x1, so we just it's part of our generating set, and here left only two, and here five of 15 and so on. This is the table of small values, and the results of the Margarete Wolf are actually of the symmetric polynomials in two variables, and it says that these fundamental sets of free generators actually consist a system that has one generator in each degree. So this is the theorem as the Margarete Wolf stated. So I already said it. So the first proof is that actually immediately falls from the general proof of the free generator generating sets of the symmetric polynomials in two variables, and actually this set is generated by these polynomials. This is the only polynomial in nth degree, and of course we can this is another proof, and let us consider the field with characteristic which is different than two. And we would like to change linearly the free generators of free algebra by y1 and y2, which are the half of the sum and half of the difference of the our generators x1 and x2. And let's have a look what the permutation 1-2 does. And this permutation acts on x2, just interchange the x1 goes to x2 and x2 to x1. But what happened with the generator their sets y1 and y2? Y1 goes to y1, but y2 goes to minus y2. But it follows that from the fact that these two symmetric algebras are the same, so that means that every polynomial in the variables y1 and y2 means that the polynomial any monomial consists y2 in even degree, because we have one minus here, but we don't need it. So such a monomials are written as in this way. So we can write it like this one, where powers of y1 could are greater or equal zeros, of course. And actually, this symmetric algebra is really generated by these polynomials. And this is again the original proof of the Margarete Wolf. But we are going again. It's not difficult actually to read it. The mathematical language is a little bit different, but it's not difficult to follow it. But let us translate in our language. And actually, by the previous theorem, we know that this symmetric algebra into non-commutative variables is a free associative algebra and has a homogeneous free generating system. And we are looking for the nth homogeneous component. We denote by powers of nth homogeneous, the vector space of homogeneous polynomials in degree n. And using the induction, and let's have an assumption that every symmetric polynomial of degree less or equal than minus one can be expressed as a polynomial of this set. What we can say that all homogeneous polynomials of degree n, they are equal to the number of these polynomials is actual to the power n, because of course we have n position where we can put the variables x1 or x2, and if we have a monomial u of x1 x2, this is different from the monomial if we interchange the place of x1 and x2. So there are 2 to the power n minus 1 the polynomials of the sum of these two monomials, and they form a basis of the vector space of symmetric polynomials of degree n. That means that the dimension of this homogeneous polynomials of degree n and this section are exactly 2 to the power n minus 1. And what happened with the polynomial of chosen from the generating set? So we want this product to be of power of degree n, and there is a one-to-one correspondence to such a product and n plus one tuple in this way. And actually, this tuple indicates the position in exactly the monomials in the F2 to F3 starts respectively. And how many are they? This product, of course, this is n minus 1 choose p minus 1 possibilities. And so when we count all of them, so find the sum, and the sum is exactly 2 to the power n minus 1 minus 1. And the products of degree n are linearly independent and span a vector subspace of codimension 1 of actually the symmetric and homogeneous component. Hence, we need one more symmetric polynomial to express all homogeneous symmetric polynomial of degree n. And now, what happened with non-commutative symmetric polynomials after the Margarete Wolf? Symmetric function in commutative variables are starting from different points of view. But the same happened in non-commutative case as well. So the next results in this direction appears more than 30 years later in the paper of Bergman-Kohn, where the authors generalized the main result of Margaret Wolf. And there is an enormous list of literature devoted to different aspects of the theory. We mentioned some of them, and they are in the presentation, which will be available somewhere. I don't know exactly where. Let me continue. What follows? We assume that the field K will be with characteristic zero. And as a in commutative case, we assume that the general linear algebra acts on the vector space XD and extend this action diagonally on the free algebra KXD by the rule. And if J is a subgroup of general linear group, then the algebra of G invariants is consists, of course, of the all polynomials all polynomials in D variables non-commuting, which are invariant under the action of elements of the group G. And now the natural question is which results in commutative invariant theory holds also in the non-commutative case, and of course which results are not true. And now, if the group acts on the vector space with the basis XD by a scalar multiplication, if G consists of scalar matrices. So if G is finite and acts by a scalar multiplication, then G is a cyclic group. And if the order of G is Q, then this G algebra of G invariants is generated by all the monomials of degree Q. But the number of such monomials are equal D to the power Q, and hence this algebra of G invariants is isomorphic to a free algebra of K of D to the power Q variables. And it turns out that the analog of the theorem of Emmy-Noether for the finite generation of the G invariants of the polynomial algebra for finite group holds for the G invariants in the free, actually in the polynomial in non-commutative case, only in a very special case. And this case is, this theorem could be found in the paper of Kuryugin, Dixon, Formanek, and Kravchenko. And the theorem says that if G is a finite group of the general linear group of degree D, then the G invariant algebra is finitely generated if and only if G acts on the vector space with the basis AXD by a scalar multiplication. And Kuryugin suggests another action, and if consider the symmetric group of degree N, which acts from the right on the homogeneous elements of degree N by this rule, and if we have an algebra equipped with this additional action, and we want the characteristic to be zero and the G is a finite group, then the algebra with this additional action is actually finitely generated. and this is this result is in the paper of Kuryugin. And analog of Chevalier-Shepard-Todd theorem. So if G is a finite subgroup of general linear group, then the algebra of a non-commutative G invariant is free. And result of Kravchenko says that if we have a mapping H to the H invariant algebra, gives one to one correspondence between subgroups of the finite group G and the free algebras of KXT containing G invariants. And let's mention some analog of Moulin formulas, result of Dick and Formanek, if G is a finite group, so the Hilbert series look like this. And the free associative algebra, if the free associative algebra is graded with respect to the grading counting of the degree of each variables in the monomial, then the Hilbert series actually looks like this. And let's have why it's a set, is a union of y1, y2, and so on. And this is the set of variables, and let the elements of yn are assumed to be of degree n. And this indices the grading of the free algebra ky. And the Hilbert series of this algebra looks like this. And here the important thing is the g of g of z and z, and this this function is actually a generating function of the graded set y, and so we can express, of course, this this function generating function. So we can express in terms of the corresponding Hilbert series. And I would like to give an example. If the field has a characteristic zero, and we embed the symmetric group of degree two into the general linear group of degree two, so the two elements look like this in this case. And we have using the theorem set, we can calculate the Hilbert series here. The Hilbert series looks like this. And then, of course, we can find the generating function of the free generators. And what we found here is that this generating function is exactly z plus z squared and so on. And what does it mean? Actually, we have the all coefficient ones, so all coefficients here are ones. So that means that we have this is actually the dimension of the corresponding corresponding y n, and that means that we have but because of this this coefficient is one, so that means that any generator of degree n is just one. So this is another way to show that when we have two non-commuting variables, the free generator the generating set consists of one polynomial in each degree. And is there an analog of Hilbert theorem? So Dick formula of Dick's Formanek formula says that if G the group is finite, so Hilbert series is a rational function. But in general case, when G is a reductive then the Hilbert area may not be rational, and here we have an example when the group is a special linear group of degree 2, so we have such a function. And what I would like to mention is also the some literature for further reading, and I think that I finish. So thank you for the attention.
Okay, yes, thank the speaker. I cannot say that this was a very nice talk because I'm one of the authors, but I hope that you enjoyed the talk. If you have any questions or comments, you can do this.
I have a question. In the theory of quantum groups, especially matrix quantum groups, they act on spaces, of course, of non-commutative variables. And this is, of course, it seems that your theory should be applicable to this. Do you know if somebody has applied your theory to quantum groups or something like this?
Okay, Vlado, I'll answer your question. In non-commutative invariant theory, there are several aspects. Here we concentrated on the property that we have a free object. The free associative algebra is the same as the polynomial algebra, but in another class. But also there is another branch of non-commutative theory where they study algebras which are not free, but also with some quantum aspects. But in the moment, I cannot give you references. I should check. Some other questions?
I like this talk very much.
Thank you very much.
And of course, he was my advisor for the PhD thesis, so I'm his scientific son.
I was lucky to be your advisor.
And I was lucky to have such an advisor.
You know, you presented me with so many great grandchildren that I would never expect without you. Okay. So I have a number of great, I have a grandchild that is Plamen Koshlukov in Brazil, and he has lots of kids, and their kids have their kids, and all of them are your posterity. So thank you, Vesselin, for all this.
Okay, there is a difference. If you have real children, if you have 20 real children, you should have a harem. This is not the case.
Well, that's too much to expect from a mathematician.
Yeah. But also I want to make some comments about the style of the talks. You see, 50 years ago, there was Department of Mathematics at the university, and there was Department of Mathematics at the to the academy, and we were integrated 50 years ago. And in that time, there was a big department of algebra and big department of mathematical logic. A little bit before the changes in the political systems, the university and the academy, they splitted this cooperation. And we became Institute first of Mathematics, then Mathematics and Informatics and Mechanics, then Institute of Mathematics and Informatics, etc. But 10 years ago, the Department of Algebra and the Department of Logic were integrated. In the beginning of the next year, we should celebrate 10 years of this one. So since the people work in quite different branches, usually the talk should have something which is, okay, I use the Russian word "liquidation", liquidation of illegacy, and the other should be something from the experts. So I think that in this case, Sylvia and me, we try to have something which was for the general audience and also something to be for experts. And also, you see, during the communist time, as students, we had to study the classics of some philosophy. And in this philosophy, one of the things which were necessary, it was to read the classics of this one. And here, I think that, I don't know whether it was good or not, but I think in mathematics, it's always good idea to have, to see what the people in the classics are done. And I think that here it was some attempt to show that some things which were done 8 years ago are still vivid. And if you open, for example, Google Scholar, you see that this paper by Margarete Wolf, she cited about 60 times, and about 10 or 20 of them are the last 3 years. So this is still a vivid topic. Do you have some other questions or comments?
I have a general comment.
Yeah.
I just want to congratulate Vesselin on his birthday. I think this is the main topic today, and I would never expect that one of my former students will be 70 years old, which means that I'm a little bit older. Okay. So, Vesselin, you achieved a lot, and I think it's very nice to see you as our friend, our colleague. And of course, you are not doing only in mathematics, but you're doing a lot for mathematics, being director of institute. And I'm just amazed how many things you achieved in your life and career. Congratulations, Vesselin.
Thank,